So far, we've been looking at a star's luminosity and brightness, the total amount of light a star produces, and the amount we see from it. However, as we saw back in the chapter on light, another way to get more information about objects in space is by looking at their color and spectroscopy. First off, stars are thermal radiators. Remember that this means that the overall shape of the spectrum they produce depends only on their temperature. In other words, a star's color depends on its temperature. The coolest stars are red stars, with surface temperatures of only a couple of thousand Kelvin. The hottest stars are blue-white stars with surface temperatures of tens of thousands of Kelvin. Our Sun is a yellow-white star with a surface temperature of 5,800 Kelvin.
In the early 19th century, astronomers started noticing that the spectra of stars displayed dark lines, which we now know are absorption lines. And by the end of the century, they were classifying stars by the patterns of lines they were seeing, using the letters A, B, C, etc. to name the different kinds of spectra. In the early 20th century, Annie Jump Cannon noticed similarities between certain spectral types, suggesting that it was better to rearrange the letters into the modern sequence of spectral classifications. O, B, A, F, G, K, and M, with L and T classes added recently. The important thing about this order of classifications is that it corresponds to the colors of stars. So the coolest stars are class M, while the hottest are class O. Our Sun is spectral class G.
We also divide each of these spectral classes into 10 subclasses, with numbers ranging from 0 to 9. So the hottest A stars are A0, then A1, A2, etc. to A9. The next cooler ones are F0, and so on. So our Sun is class G2. The picture on top shows a sampling of different spectral types. Notice that each type has a slightly different pattern of lines, and that you have to use the strength of the lines as well as which lines are visible to pin down the spectral type.
At the start of the course, we described how Cecilia Payne-Gaposchkin worked out the composition of stars using their light. What she found was that all stars have basically the same composition, 3/4 hydrogen and 1/4 helium, with a few percent or less of all the other chemical elements.
You should be wondering how that works if there are so many different types of spectra we see. However, it turns out that temperature plays a role in determining which elements can absorb in a gas. In the very hottest stars, the only absorption lines we see are from hydrogen and helium. All of the other chemical elements have lost at least one of their electrons at these temperatures, so it's harder for them to produce visible absorption lines.
On the other hand, as we start looking at cooler stars, we see a lot more lines from heavier elements, which astronomers like to call metals. But the hydrogen and helium lines disappear. If the temperature is too low, hydrogen and helium don't produce visible absorption lines. In the very coolest stars, it's even cool enough for atoms to start combining into molecules. So we see absorption from these as well. That's what gives the dense bands of absorption you can see in the M5 star. By the way, if this seems like a funny way to use the word metals, well, astronomers are just funny that way. One more thing we'd like to be able to measure about stars is their mass. Back in the chapter on motion and energy, we saw that you can use orbits to measure the masses of objects, because orbits depend on gravity, and gravity depends on mass. Fortunately, many stars are in binary or multiple star systems. This means that two or more stars stay in orbit around each other because they're pulled towards each other by their mutual gravity. If we can measure the orbital speed and the distance between the stars, we can find their masses.
We usually list star masses in solar masses. Remember from the math notes that a solar mass is 2 times 10 to the 30th kilograms. The most massive stars we see are between 100 and 200 solar masses. There are very few of these in our galaxy. The smallest stars have as little as 0.07 solar masses. These very low mass stars are the most abundant around us. There are objects even smaller than this. We call them brown dwarfs. As we'll see later, brown dwarfs are small enough that their cores never get hot enough for stable hydrogen fusion like our sun. Anything as small as 0.013 solar masses, about 1/100th the mass of the sun, is considered a brown dwarf. In comparison, the largest planet in our solar system, Jupiter, is 0.001 solar masses, 1,000 times smaller than the sun in mass. Jupiter would have to be 70 times larger than it is now just to reach the minimum size to be considered a star.
In general, there are many more of the smaller stars than there are of the larger stars. So the vast majority of the stars are much smaller than our sun. We don't know if this trend continues as we get down into brown dwarfs. They're much harder to see, so it's more challenging to get a good sense of how many of them there are. One of the favorite tricks in science is to make a graph of two different quantities and see if you can find any connections between them. In the early 20th century, two astronomers, Einar Hertzsprung and Henry Norris Russell, put together graphs of absolute magnitudes versus colors. Remember that the absolute magnitude tells us the luminosity, and color tells us the surface temperature. The diagram they produced is still called the HR diagram, and if you know where a star goes on this diagram, you can tell a tremendous amount about it.
Here's what an HR diagram looks like. Notice that the vertical axis can be listed as either luminosity or absolute magnitude, and of course, smaller magnitude means brighter. The horizontal axis is listed with hot blue O stars on the left side, while cool red M stars are on the right side. This is backwards if you're thinking of a numerical measurement of temperature. So this means that stars on the bottom right part of the diagram are cool and dim, while stars at the top left are hot and luminous.
When you look at an HR diagram, one of the first things you notice is that the stars aren't just random. They appear in specific groupings that depend on their size and evolutionary state. The most important groups are the main sequence cutting across the middle, the giants and supergiants in the top right corner, and the white dwarfs in the bottom left corner. We'll look at each of these individually.
The vast majority of stars we find around us in space are part of the main sequence. As we'll see later, the reason for this is that the main sequence is where stars spend most of their lives. Physically, the main sequence consists of stars that generate energy the same way the sun does. They fuse hydrogen into helium in their cores. In fact, the sun is near the middle of the main sequence shown here.
The main sequence is special. There are a lot of trends here that we don't see with other stars. For example, the hotter stars are also the more luminous stars. What this really means is that most main sequence stars have similar radii. The ones near the top are bigger than the ones near the bottom, but they're not a lot bigger.
Another important trend here is mass. We find that the higher luminosity stars are also the higher mass stars. O and B main sequence stars are much more massive than K and M main sequence stars. From this, we can tell something else about the main sequence. Stars don't move around much on it. Except at the very beginning and end of a star's life, its mass hardly changes at all. So while it's on the main sequence, it stays in one place. Stars don't evolve up and down this sequence.
Note that this is not true for non-main sequence stars. It's very hard to tell from its spectral type what the mass of a giant or supergiant star will be. Since a star of a given mass moves back and forth along these parts of the HR diagram.
Stars in the upper right corner of the HR diagram are called giants and supergiants. It's easy to see why. These stars have very high luminosities, typically much higher luminosities than main sequence stars with the same temperature. Remember earlier when we described luminosity, we said it was flux times surface area. A cool star has low flux, meaning each square meter of surface doesn't produce much light. However, if the cool star is very big, then it makes a lot of light, just because it has a big surface.
Giants and supergiants can be hundreds or thousands of times the radius of the sun. The largest supergiants can have radii of up to 10 astronomical units. Remember that an AU is the average distance between the Earth and Sun. So if you put a star like this into our solar system, it would fill up the whole inner solar system, and its surface would extend out to the orbits of the outer planets. Betelgeuse, a supergiant star in Orion, is an example of this. Even though these stars have much larger radii than main sequence stars, their masses are not any larger. In fact, some have less mass than the Sun. Instead, supergiant stars have very low average densities. Their outer layers are puffed out to where they're very tenuous. As we'll see later, giant stars evolve from main sequence stars.
As we said earlier, there isn't a clear mass trend here the way we see for main sequence stars. You can't tell what the mass of a giant will be just from its spectral type.
The other obvious group of outlying stars are the white dwarfs. These appear below the main sequence, so they're hot, but not very luminous. We can use the same argument we did for giant stars here. The only way for a hot star to be faint is to make it small. So white dwarf stars must be much smaller than main sequence stars. In fact, typical white dwarf stars are only around 10,000 kilometers in radius, not much bigger than the Earth. So they are stars that have been squeezed down to the size of a planet.
Here's the Sirius A and B binary star system. Sirius A is an ordinary spectral class A main sequence star. Its companion, Sirius B, is about the same temperature, but it's a much fainter white dwarf. In fact, Sirius B was one of the first white dwarf stars recognized in the sky. Despite their small sizes, white dwarfs' masses are still stellar, typically between 0.5 and 1.4 solar masses. Once again, there isn't an obvious trend here, so you can't tell a white dwarf's mass from where it is on the HR diagram.
Astronomers eventually confirmed that there were systematic differences between the spectra of giant stars versus main sequence stars. These differences were subtle and depended on the fact that giant stars have weaker gravity and hence atmospheres that extend over a much larger distance.
Nonetheless, we can recognize the differences between main sequence stars and different kinds of giant stars from the spectra alone. This lets us define the luminosity classes. We use Roman numerals to list these classes, so supergiants are Roman numeral 1, while ordinary giants are Roman numeral 3. Main sequence stars are Roman numeral 5. Luminosity classes 2 and 4 are between the other classes. I should also mention that white dwarf stars have very different looking spectra than other stars with the same temperature, so they're not usually included in the luminosity classes. This is partially due to the extremely high gravity in their atmospheres, and partially due to the fact that they have very different composition from other stars. This is a result of how they evolved. We'll see more about this in the next presentation.
So we've now seen two different ways of classifying stars, by spectral classes and by luminosity classes. Often, we list both of these together with the spectral class first, followed by the luminosity class. So, for example, the spectral luminosity class of the Sun is G2V. That means it's a moderate temperature star, that's the G2, and it's a main sequence star, that's the Roman numeral 5. Let's see if you can plot some stars. Draw an HR diagram and show where you would place the following stars. Would they be main sequence, giants, supergiants, white dwarfs? Notice that some are listed by spectral luminosity class, and others are listed by temperature and luminosity. You should be able to plot them with either set of information.